Archbishop Gregory, and my brothers and sisters in Christ, what a privilege and honor to be able to speak today as we bring my friend, my bishop, my mentor, and one so esteemed by all of us as we commend him to the Lord and bring him to his place of burial. At our Diocesan Eucharistic Congress in 1995, the principal speaker was Archbishop Francis Stafford, now Cardinal Stafford, and he was a contemporary of Bishop Gossman from Baltimore. And at the Eucharistic Congress, he said of Bishop Gossman, he said, "Joe Gossman is a man of the Eucharist. He has a Eucharistic heart." And I suggest that we think of Francis Joseph Gossman in these terms this morning, for he believed the words of Jesus with his whole being, that the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. What does it mean to be a man of the Eucharist? First of all, it is to have complete faith in the passion and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, and to know that we today, as well as were our ancestors in faith over these past 2,000 years, we are invited to meet the Lord at this altar every day. At the altar, Bishop Gossman found strength. He found love. He found the ability to go forth each day to preach the gospel in truth and strength without wavering. Bishop Gossman brought to the altar his own hopes and dreams, his disappointments and frustrations, knowing that the Lord who fed him the Eucharistic bread would walk with him throughout the day. Joseph Gossman was a gentle but ardent servant of the gospel, gentle in that he listened with loving care, not judging the person, only judging the sin, ardent that he didn't waver from the truth even while accepting all persons into his caring arms. Joseph Gossman didn't find it easy to be out in front. Actually, he usually found him in the back of the room. He didn't want the limelight, nor the personal attention that invariably came to him. He just wanted to be a part of the people. He epitomized the words of Pope Francis to the papal representatives concerning bishops, that they are able to watch over the flock, to keep watch, endure hope, that they have sun and light in their hearts to lovingly and patiently support the plans which God brings about in his people. And that was Bishop Gossman. He often meditated on the words of St. Augustine, words which he had printed on his invitation to both his episcopal ordination in 1968 and to his installation as fourth bishop of Raleigh in 1975. And I quote, "What I am for you terrifies me. What I am with you consoles me. For you, I am a bishop. But with you, I am a Christian. The first is an office accepted. The second, a grace received. The first is a danger. The second, salvation. If then I am gladder by far to be redeemed with you than I am to be placed over you, I shall, as the Lord himself commanded, be more completely your servant." And those were the words of Augustine. In this conviction, to be more completely your servant, Bishop Gossman was strong and determined. Even when many of the faithful condemned him for publicly supporting the textile workers or the farm workers of North Carolina, he went forward knowing that the love of Jesus, the love made strong in the daily Eucharist, strengthened him. He was not an arrogant or angry confrontation. His was the loving, caring, patient presentation of what was morally right. Joining with Bishop Curlin of Charlotte, he wrote the pastoral, One Mind, One Heart. Not only farm workers and textile workers had to be promoted, protected, and assisted in our society, but all working people must be treated with love and dignity and respect, and their welfare protected. Not popular sentiments in this angry and greedy world in which we live, but profound truths first taught by Jesus Christ and passionately promoted by Bishops Gossman and Curlin. Bishop Gossman lived a simple life. He was always happy to be among his people, especially among his priests. He always had a camera taking pictures. Now, I have to admit, I never saw any of those pictures, and I don't know if anybody else ever did. I'm not even sure he had film in the camera. But everyone would smile and let the bishop take their picture, and we all went away happy, thinking that someday we might see these. I assure you, I have been through all of Bishop Gossman's belongings. I have not found those pictures. But whether it was a cookout, a pig picking, a birthday party, or a simple meal at a family home, he was there, ready to join in the fun and laughter. He could see and enjoy the humorous side of things, and often sent those gathered with him into laughter by his dry, subtle humor. Fathers, forgive me. Right before he retired, Bishop Gossman was invited to a parish, and the pastor introduced him as Bishop Waters. Bishop Waters was our third bishop who died in 1974. There was silence when Bishop Waters got up and went to the microphone. He looked at the pastor and smilingly said, Bishop Waters might be alive and living, but I'm here and I'm Bishop Gossman. Everyone broke out in laughter, including Bishop Gossman, who led the laugh. His simplicity was exemplified in the very beginning of his ministry in Raleigh, from when he introduced himself, I am your brother Joseph, at his installation as our bishop, to the reception afterwards on the plaza in front of Memorial Auditorium, which was adorned with balloons. And by the way, these balloons were the first purchase he made in the Diocese of Raleigh. And he bought them the day before, and they decorated the plaza. And there his flock enjoyed popcorn and pimento sandwiches and southern, that is, sweet tea. And this was prepared mostly by a group of ladies from Christ Episcopal Church. Bishop Gossman oversaw the tremendous growth of our diocese during his 31 years as our shepherd. He often said that our problem of growth was certainly better than the problem of closures that many other dioceses were facing. He dedicated more than 60 churches, schools, and parish facilities. As our bishop, he desired to involve consecrated religious and the laity in the formal work of the church. Within a year of his ministry, all the diocesan offices, save two, were headed by lay or religious personnel. He appointed consecrated religious, deacons, and lay people to serve as pastoral administrators under the guidance of pastors in 10 parishes and missions. He reached out to the total community, and I'm grateful for the presence of Bishop Estelle of the Episcopal Diocese and his brothers and sisters of the clergy of our ecumenical churches for their presence here, because Bishop gave himself to the work of bringing the fullness of Christ to our whole world, that we could come together in unity. This morning, we know in our hearts that Bishop Gossman has gone to the reward of a faithful servant. I'm sure that after 3 years of confinement to bed and wheelchair, he is happily darting about in sparks of stubble. We have missed the presence of this servant of God for 3 years now, and we will continue to miss him with the finality of death. But death does not conquer the Christian. Rather, it leads him into the hands of our loving Lord. So now we say, dear Brother Joseph, dear Bishop Joseph, you have served well. You have fought the good fight. You have loved and been loved. You are now in the hand of God. Thank you for being the ardent but gentle servant, shepherd, bishop, friend, brother that you were and always will be for us. May you rest in peace.